There are no bystanders in the war of life and death. No place the battle cannot reach. So fight it, without remorse of relenting. For death will surely do the same.
The Legio Custodes are the epitome of the Emperor's will made manifest. Handcrafted by the Master of Mankind, these gold-clad paragons of the Imperium are each a monument to the toils of the Wars of Unification and the Emperor's vision for a united galaxy. Yet such demigods of war would require a leader of unparalleled martial strength, discipline, and wisdom to rival the influence of the High Lords and even the Regent of Terra. The indomitable soldier and champion of the Emperor, Constantin Valdor. The deeds of the Captain General of the Legio Custodes would prove crucial in enabling the foundations of the Imperium to be built. Upon the war-torn world of Terra, humanity would exist as a tattered and divided people. Techno-barbarian warlords would fight for supremacy of their fiefdoms as the carnage of their skirmishes ravaged the already barren landscapes of humanity's ancestral home. Yet within the bleak dystopia of Terra, a man of vision would ascend. Known only to his people as the Emperor, the perpetual witness to humanity's greatest glories and downfalls would refuse to remain an onlooker as the people of Terra fought for scraps. Organizing the brightest minds of humanity into the fold of his leadership, the Emperor would see to the construction of warriors capable of carrying out his will. Gene forged of Terra's promising stock within laboratories staffed by genius minds of biological marvels, the first demigods of war would be crafted by the Emperor's own hand. So unique and mastercrafted would be their providence that no warriors of the Imperium, save for the Emperor's future sons, would match their divine poise, stature, and might. Drawing from his knowledge of the artifacts of humanity's dark age of technology, the Emperor would intricately mold his firstborn sons. Only one in 1,000 aspirants of Terra would survive the procedures to achieve their transformation, yet each and every one of the Custodes would be a priceless warrior capable of sundering entire armies. Alongside their subordinate killers, the Thunder Warriors, the Custodes would purge Terra of the techno-barbarian hordes. Led by Constantin Valdor, the few thousands of warriors who would one day accrue to the amount of a legio would cleanse Terra of its warring rabble. Yet with Terra firmly within the Emperor's grasp, a new war would be required to reclaim the stars. One which would not require the service of the Thunder Warriors. As the first of the Custodian Guard, Constantin Valdor would serve as the foremost general of the Wars of Unification. Serving alongside the Thunder Warriors and the Primarch of their 4th Legion, Ushotan, Valdor would be a striking contrast to his compatriot. Whilst the commander of the Iron Lords of the Thunder Warriors acted in a brash, fiery, and heavy-handed manner, Valdor would stand as an imposing, cold, yet almost gentle soul. Duty would be the foremost virtue of the Custodian Guard, and none would shake their loyalty to their liege. Commanded to cull the Thunder Warriors during the Battle of Mount Ararat, the Custodians would enact their master's will without pause or restraint. Ushotan would rally his men to hide within the dark corners of Terra until with the aid of the Grand Provost Marshal of the Adeptus Arbites, Uoma Kandawaya, and geneticist Amor Astarte lead a conspiracy to bring the Custodians to justice. Resolving to remove Constantin Valdor from his position of authority, the surviving Thunder Warriors would demand to put him on trial for the massacre of their kin. Yet within the partially constructed Imperial Palace of the new Imperium, Valdor would confront the conspirators alone. Valdor would demand the surrender of the Thunder Warriors, yet Ushotan would not bend his knee to the murderer of his brethren. Though seemingly fated to fall by the blades of his enemies, Valdor would not enter the Senatorum Imperialis without aid. Amor Astarte had grown the Primarchs of the new Imperium, yet with the intervention of an unknown force, they had been taken from Terra and cast across the stars. Yet from their genetic materials, a new breed of warriors had begun to be forged. The Angels of Death of the First Legion would flood the Imperial Palace as 10,000 Astartes began to cut down the Thunder Warriors. Inferior in raw strength, the First Legion would nonetheless prove adept at coordinating their maneuvers and swiftly fell the Thunder Legion. Dueling Valdor in single combat, Ushatan would be no match for the Captain General of the Custodian Guard. Taking no gratification in the deed, Valdor would slay his once compatriot and allow Uoma Kandawaya to live in secret should she not interfere with the Emperor's reign. For much work remained to build the Imperium, and Valdor was now enshrined as a pillar of its foundation. Installed as a member of the Triumvirate, Valdor would serve as the Emperor's right hand alongside the secretive ancient, Malkador the Sigillite. Gifted the Emperor's own personal weapon during the Wars of Unification, the Apollonian Spear, the newly appointed Chief Custodian would observe the burgeoning Imperium. Terran aspirants would be drafted into the now established Legiones Astartes as the Emperor continued to handcraft his own custodians to swell their ranks. Seeking to unite all the fragments of humanity throughout the galaxy to join the Imperium, the ceramite-clad warriors of the Space Marines would form the vast armies to bring compliance to hazardous worlds and perilous star systems. The Legio Custodes would reach their peak of 10,000 warriors after a century of conquest during the Great Crusade. Now known as the First of the 10,000, with the reunion of the Lost Primarchs brought into the fold of the Imperium, Valdor would in all but name be regarded as the Liege of the Custodes, akin in stature to the Emperor's sons. Yet Valdor would seek no glory in conquest, nor ambitions for power. As is custom for the Legio Custodes, the inside of their armor is engraved with honor names and titles earned in conquest, imparted by the Emperor himself. Valdor would gain 932 such names during his service, far in excess of any of his order. Wary of the Primarchs of the Imperium, Constantin would surmise that the archenemy of humanity, whom had scattered them across the stars, had spared them for malevolent purpose. Insistent that his custodians could lead mortal armies to reclaim humanity without the influence of the Emperor's sons, Valdor would believe the Primarchs to be corruptible by the manipulations of the ruinous powers. Despite the Master of Mankind's dismissal of his firstborn's misgivings, Valdor's concerns would be proven true as the Great Crusade drew to a close. Horus Lupercal, chosen son of the Emperor and War Master of the Imperium, would become thrall to chaos. Attempting to warn the Emperor of the impending betrayal, the Primarch of the Thousand Suns, Magnus the Red, would project his psychic form to the throne world. Censured from using warp-drawn powers with the Emperor's Decree of Nicaea, Magnus's actions would cause catastrophic damage to the Imperial Palace's psychic wards and destroy all hope of the Emperor's Webway project. A venture which, if successful, would allow humanity to traverse the galaxy without delving into the tumultuous tides of the warp, to which Magnus would damn the Imperium to forever endure the treacherous Great Ocean. Dispatching the Space Wolves Legion to bring Magnus and his Legion to Terra for trial, Constantin Valdor and a detachment of his Legio and the Sisters of Silence would aid the Sixth Legion in their task. Yet the orders of the Master of Mankind would be intercepted by Horus Lupercal, and with his treachery unknown to the wider Imperium, the War Master would command Lieben Russ to execute the Thousand Suns. Already embittered at the 15th Legion's flagrant abuses of the powers of the Warp, the Wolf King of Fenris would be all too willing to slaughter the Thousand Suns. Making planetfall on the world of Prospero, the Vilka Fenrica would burn the City of Light to the ground, whilst Valdor and his men slew numerous captains of the 15th Legion. Battling the Kenitai Blademasters of the Thousand Suns, Valdor's martial skill would prove superhuman in nature. For while the Kenetai bore the psychic foresight of seeing their foes' actions before they would be commit to the material realm, and would outnumber Valdor 30-1, all would perish. The Thousand Sons would be devastated, forcing Magnus to submit a part of his soul to the ruinous powers in exchange for their deliverance from the Space Wolves' fury. Prospero would be consumed by warp rifts as the City of Light would be transported to the seat of power of the Chaos Gods, the Eye of Terra. Returning to the Throne World, Valdor would learn in detail of Horus's betrayal and would begin the great task of defending the Imperial Palace from the impending invasion of the Traitor Rebellion. Due to Magnus's actions, a tear in real space had breached the Imperial Palace. Despite the best efforts of the Emperor to seal the breach to the palace, a vast army would be required to repel a demonic invasion from the Immaterium. The Legio Custodes, alongside the Adeptus Mechanicum and Imperial Army forces, would battle within the now corrupted Eldar Webway for 5 Terran standard years. Led by the Master of Mankind, even the unparalleled might of the Legio Custodes would prove insufficient in combating the forces of Chaos. Yet for Constantin Valdor, his presence would be required within the material realm. Working alongside Malgador the Sigilite and Primarch of the 7th Legion, Rogal Dorn, the great work of reinforcing the Imperial Palace for the impending invasion would begin. Forming the Terran War Council, the Fabricator Locum Trimegia of Mars, Fabricator General Zagreus Kane, and Oblivion Knight of the Silent Sisterhood, Kyria, would aid the Defenders of Terra in their endeavor. Orchestrating an assassination attempt to slay Horus Lupercal, Valdor would champion any methods of war should they achieve the objective of slaying the War Master. Advising the Assassinorum to dispatch a team of members of every clade to carry out the mission to slay the Lupercal, such methods of war would cause Rogal Dorn to continually berate the Sigilite and Valdor. Arguing that Constantine's place was to protect the Emperor, the Praetorian of Terra and his legion would safeguard the Imperium. With the failure of the Executioner Force's assassination attempt of the War Master, the War Council of Terra would prepare for the inevitable siege of the Throne World. For 9 brutal years, the Horus Heresy would wage throughout the galaxy and toll the death knell of the Imperium. Yet with the arrival of the Blood Angels, White Scars, and their Primarchs to the Throne World, the Loyalists of Terra would brace themselves for the impending final battle of the war. During 014.M31, the Traitor Legions and their amassed strength would breach the Sol System. The Emperor's Children, Iron Warriors, World Eaters, Death Guard, Thousand Sons, Sons of Horus, and smaller contingents of the Night Lords and Word Bearers would enact their siege of the Imperial Palace. Untold billions would perish as both mortal men and transhuman warriors shed their blood as the traitors hurled themselves against the walls of the Emperor's Palace. At the vanguard of the most deadly of battlefields, Valdor and his men would confront and drive back their opponents as endless waves of horrific butchers, zealots, and horrors fought in their place. Leading the defense of the Colossi Gate, alongside the Primarch of the White Scars, Jagatai Khan, and Blood Angel's first captain, Raldoron, despite their valiant efforts, such protracted warfare would not be sustainable. After 55 days of battle, Horus Lupercal would challenge the Emperor. Knowing the impending arrival of the Ultramarines, Dark Angels, and Space Wolves to be too great to counter, time had run out for the War Master. Lowering the shield of his flagship, the Vengeful Spirit, the Emperor would not cower from his wayward son's ultimatum to end the war personally. Ever his liege's stalwart and loyal companion, Valdor would accompany the Emperor on his assault of the Vengeful Spirit. At their side, the Primarchs Rogal Dorn and Sanguinius, alongside their mightiest warriors and a contingent of the Imperial Army, would infiltrate the Lupercal's court and slay the War Master. Yet during their teleportation to the Vengeful Spirit, the Emperor and his champions would be separated. surrounded by demonic entities upon their infiltration of the ship. Valdor and his men would carve their way to the Lupercal's court of the War Master of Chaos. Tormented at the prospect of his liege being left unaided in the battle against the War Master, Valdor would fight more furiously than ever to reach his master. Though no matter how hard the Captain General would fight, he would never reach the Emperor in time. The Master of Mankind would destroy Horus Lupercal, yet incur fatal injuries during the battle. The Great Angel lay dead. The Loyalists had incurred many scars, and the Father of Humanity would be interred upon the Golden Throne within the Imperial Palace. With the traitors in full retreat with the fall of their Dark King, the Loyalist reinforcements would arrive too late to prevent catastrophe. Constantin Valdor would renounce his title and position as Captain General of the Legio Custodes. Grief-stricken at their failure to protect the Emperor, the Custodians would swear a penitent oath to avenge their liege and consign themselves to remain on Terra forevermore. Removing their red cloaks in exchange for black to mark their shame, the now Adeptus Custodes would consign themselves to the Long Vigil to watch over their maimed liege. The Loyalist Legions and their Primarchs would hound the traitors as they fled to the Eye of Terra during the time known as the Great Scouring, yet Valdor would not join them in their retributive pursuit. Arming himself with his armor and the Apollonian spear, Valdor would depart the Imperial Palace in the dead of night, and with his last gaze of the Imperial Palace, utter the words, "Only in death." His deeds are known to this day. There are whispers across the broken Imperium that Valdor continues to fight for the Emperor to this day. Believing the Emperor to have foreseen his inevitable fate, Constantin would never falter in his faith in the Master of Mankind's vision, even in the face of annihilation. Records of an enigmatic figure, known only as the King in Yellow, still persist deep within the dark corners of the galaxy. Yet if there is credibility of such an individual being the first of the 10,000, bears scrutiny. For his loyalty to the Emperor has been absolute, and his devotion to his ideals uncompromising. Yet in the darkest days of the Imperium, as the forces of heretics, Xenos, and Chaos suffocate the light of the Emperor, the innocents of humanity cry out for salvation. And with the resurgence of the legends of old, such as the Avenging Sun and Lion of Caliban, perhaps one day, the stoic firstborn of the Emperor shall return to his father's side. Unseen by everyone else, the glimmer from the distant hill blinked once, then twice.
"Let me tell you who I am," said the Custodian. "My name is Constantin Valdor, Captain General of the Legio Custodes, and I hold the power of the Emperor's displeasure in my hands."
The gang leader snorted with cold amusement. "Your brain is broke, that's what you have."
"I will prove it to you."
Valdor raised his arm and pointed a finger at the gunner behind the multilaser.
"In the Emperor's name," he said, his tone calm and conversational. "Death."
A heartbeat later, the gunner's upper torso exploded into chunks of meat on a blast of pink fluids. The fear that the Emperor's name had briefly conjured returned tenfold. Valdor pointed to the rifleman standing over Tariel.
"And death," he went on.
The junk hunter's body bifurcated at the spine with a wet chug, collapsing to the sand.
"And death, and death, and death."
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer.
Constantin Valdor would witness both the greatest glories and worst downfalls of the Emperor's Imperium. Yet no matter the circumstance, he would remain loyal to his liege and his duty to defend his people. While loyalty is a virtue worth championing, be mindful not to mistake it for fanaticism. For should your loyalty be misplaced, it shall bring you to the precipice of misfortune, as many are deceitful in their shows of benevolence and are quick to betray your subjection.